There are deep divisions among Scotland's Christians. The majority of Scots are Protestants, but nearly one in five are Catholic, mostly descended from Irish immigrants. Celtic Football Club was set up in Glasgow by those Irish Catholics, while their rivals Glasgow Rangers became identified with the Protestant cause. Most Catholics are educated in their own state-funded schools, and the divide between the two communities is maintained by football fans, religious faith, and marching flute bands.
Said a father to his son, "Oh my boy, the time has come. Our country it is calling unto thee. While those rebels once again to unite us is their aim, and together
I'm Sam.
We must
I'm from the east end of Glasgow. A Rangers supporter and a Protestant.
Yeah!
I preferred to have 11 great players that were Protestant playing for the blue jersey. It's the tradition when Protestant is important. Without it, we'd probably just been another club.
I'm Paddy Campbell. I'm a Catholic and I'm a Celtic supporter, and I live in Glasgow. It's just a chance of birth, whether you're born a Catholic or born a Protestant, but as soon as you're born a Catholic or a Protestant, you know right away, I'm a Catholic, so I have to hate a Protestant, or I support Celtic, so I have to hate Rangers.
As soon as you see your first splash of green, a Republic Island jersey, something inside you just snaps. Automatically, you're just thinking, Fenian bastards, I want to do them.
Yeah, Celtic's Catholic identity is very important. I mean, you can't get away from the fact that it was set up to help poor Irish Catholics in Glasgow just before the turn of the century. I'm sure if somebody from England that doesn't even know what it's like to live in Glasgow, which is a divided city religiously, they would say, oh, that is childish. But up here in Glasgow, it's a lot different than that. It is heartfelt. They do get carried away, but they're not thinking about it. It's subconscious. But an outsider coming to Glasgow that's never seen anything like this before, they'd see it as childish and just it would seem like wee boys, what 7 or 8 year olds would do in the street. As I was taught, beliefs of the Catholic Church, I mean, that's all I was brought up in, so obviously I believe all that's true. It's important for me, I've just been brought up going to Mass on a Sunday, Holy Communion, confession. I couldn't see myself being anything other than a Catholic now.
When was the last time you were at Mass, Addy? The last time Celtic played Rangers?
I hate Rangers.
Rangers are the best.
Rangers are the crappiest.
I've not got any Protestant friends, but it's not because I hate Protestants. It's just because the circles I move in, there's no Protestants involved in that.
Where Pope smokes a dope.
I wouldn't marry a Protestant simply because I'm a Catholic, and if I ever had any children, I'd want them to be brought up in the Catholic religion.
Catholics feel as if they're guilty. They've got to go and confess their sins to a priest who knows nothing about reality, about normal living, knows nothing about marriage, pregnancy, whatever. They know nothing. And they're going to go there and talk to a priest, and as well talk to me.
It's about freedom of thought. We're free to think whatever we like. We're not dictated to by somebody who's only a priest, who isn't he God, what they maybe believe is God.
Rangers are the biggest club outside of the Church of Scotland.
Yeah.
What a load of shite. Half of them never going to fucking church in their life. Protestant bastards.
The majority of Rangers supporters that go to Ibrox on a Saturday, the majority of them aren't Protestants. I mean, I'd say it would be the small minority of them that call themselves Protestants would actually go to church on a Sunday. But the majority of them call themselves Protestants because Protestants seems to be the opposite from Catholics. But they're not Protestants, all they are is atheists.
To be a Protestant is about freedom. We're free as to do whatever we want as long as we're law-abiding citizens.
As our name says, they're just protesting, and it seems that they've protested against God, and they seem to think they were right and God was wrong. What they've done is just said, we can't live to these rules, we want to do something else, so we'll start our own church up.
They're just ignorance. I mean, I don't know why they keep slagging the Pope. What's the Pope ever done to them? Nothing.
The Pope is a dictator. He sits in Rome and he's telling his priests what to do. He's no got a clue about what's happening in the East End of Glasgow, places like Easterhouse, Gathamlock, Shettleston, Bayliston. He's no got a clue. Young lassies maybe get, see, a young girl might get raped and she goes to the priest for advice. The priest says she can't have an abortion. That's all wrong. It's total wrong, all because the Pope said it.
They'll sing the Pope, but why do they sing that? I mean, if it's not because they hate the Pope and he's this evil guy that's done something to harm them, it's just because the Catholics see the Pope as the leader on earth.
Hang him! Hang him!
He's some
he is Satan. He is Satan. Pope is Satan as far as I'm concerned anyway. He is Satan. We're all one. It's the same God.
Bullshit, right. Man. We fucking hate right. You bastards.
We.
Don't give your shit,
we. Man. Our man's the Pope. Oh, right. I don't know who their boss on earth is, but when we die, we're all going to the same place.
The thing that I hate the most about them really is singing about the Queen. Affiliation with loyalists in Northern Ireland.
I'm a loyalist mainly because I'm a Rangers supporter. You go to see Rangers, you're in amongst with a loyalist crowd. You're buying loyalist newspapers, whatever. You're reading about the political situation in Northern Ireland. It's a situation that I support the loyalist people there. Therefore, I feel I'm a loyalist. I'm a unionist. I believe in the union. I believe that Northern Ireland should be kept within the union. I believe in the Queen, the monarchy. Support the royal family. And I support the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. Sash My Father War. It's a traditional song, Loyalist Scotland and Loyalist Northern Ireland. It's to do with the Orange Order. Obviously, Celtic Catholics don't like that. It celebrates victories over the Papist King James, and it gave Britain the freedom to think Protestant. It gave them the Bill of Rights and the Protestant religion.
I don't think the Orange Order is anything else except a totally anti-Catholic organisation, and they're not marching for liberty and they're not marching for anything else. What they are marching for is to aggravate the Catholics.
So we wake up in the mornings, I look out my front window and I've got a perfect view of Celtic Park. That's the first thing I see. It's a nice one. Celtic Park to me is a breeding ground for republicanism, Catholicism, Sinn Féin, IRA, and everything I oppose.
Rangers supporters are singing pro-loyalist songs, so we'll do the exact opposite and we'll combat that with pro-IRA songs. But there are people that feel strongly about it, that go and support Celtic, that actually feel it's right to sing these songs because they believe in what the Republicans in Northern Ireland, the Republican paramilitaries are doing.
During the game, when you hear them singing and chanting about the IRA, you just wish your stand would just fall down on top of them and maybe give them a wee taste of their own medicine, what the Provos have been doing to British civilians for the last 25 years. You just feel like these IRA sympathisers deserve everything they're going to get. I despise republicanism. I despise Celtic for it. It's an evil, it's a cancer, it should be cut out.
If the push came to the shove, I would definitely fight for Northern Ireland. I would enrol myself in a paramilitary organisation.
I could never see a Rangers team that were dominated by Catholics, there was more Catholics than Protestants in it, simply because their support serum. There wouldn't be any demand. And Rangers and Celtic now are just a business, and that would be a bad business move by Rangers to sign that many Catholics. As a low Celtic, they've got no thing that says we don't sign Protestants. I don't really think Fergus McCann or whoever's in charge would sign a lot of Protestants for the same fact that a lot of people would just say, this is, things are falling a bit here, we're not coming back, we don't want to see this. And it would be a bad business move for them.
I wouldn't say I was a bigot. I'm somebody that believes in my own culture. This is our country and it's our tradition, it's our culture. We don't ask them to be here, but they're here. Well, in our country, they should abide by our laws. They should accept it. We don't go and force the Protestant religion down the Catholics' throats. Why should they do it with us?
I don't think Catholics will, in the west of Scotland anyway, in Glasgow, will ever really be accepted fully. The strife between the Catholics and the Protestants in Glasgow will always be there and will never disappear. I can't see it happening anyway.
Friends and swap telephone numbers 08 94 79 79 79.
New at Woolworths, Box Hits 98, Volume 2. The hottest summer hits with Vindaloo, The Mavericks, and number ones from The Tampera and Aqua. The biggest hits on the planet. Box Hits 2, out now at Woolworths.
In Lanarkshire, religious faith is strong. Although they live side by side, most Catholics and Protestants attend separate schools from the age of five.
I'm Maureen Campbell. This is my husband, John. This is my daughter, Yvonne. She's 15. Jacqueline, she's 13. Brian, he's 9. And Fiona, who's 6. We belong to St Francis Xavier Parish, Kirfin. I was always brought up a Catholic, and we bring our family up. Their children up as Catholics.
My name is Charles Kefferty.
My immediate family would be my wife Vivian, who courted since we were very, very young. We now have an addition to our family, which is a little girl, Amy, at 14 months.
Vivian and I have been members of the Orange Order for over 10 years.
An Orange man, first and foremost, believes in the Reformed Protestant Evangelical faith.
I was born into the Catholic faith. I belong to a fairly strong Catholic family. We were handed that faith on by our parents, and I certainly will try to hand it on to my children. That's the only way that the faith will live. If you don't do that, then the faith just dies.
We're on our way up to the district master's house. This is a traditional thing on the Friday prior to the march, that some of the boys would get together and assist him and help him put his flags up, his bunting up, to add to the lustre and the colour of the demonstration.
Sure it's all bad, still is beautiful, and its colours they are fine. It was
the adult population of the village is probably something like 3,000. I could quite confidently say that membership in the order would be somewhere in the region of 1 in 10, which is very, very high compared to other villages and indeed other parts in Scotland.
The walk tomorrow, dance. Can we see the bands, aren't we? Yes.
The Orange Order would, in the village, would be an extension of not just my family, but everybody's family. And indeed, there'd be very few households who didn't have a member in the order.
If Amy had a Catholic boyfriend, I certainly wouldn't disown her or forget that she ever existed. If she was serious in marrying him, I would be upset, but I certainly can't tell her she can't marry him. That would be her decision. It's against the beliefs to enter the chapel. I'm afraid I couldn't get into the chapel to see her being married. I would certainly go to the rest of the ceremony, but I went to enter the chapel.
Hopefully any children that were born in the family would be brought up in the Catholic faith.
If one of the children said that they wanted to marry outside the Catholic Church, they wanted to marry a Protestant, I won't pretend that that wouldn't concern me. It would concern me. There's a triangle. The church, the family and the school are all part of the triangle. You took one of those, the family, the church, or the school, away, then the whole thing becomes quite meaningless.
We have two little boys, for example, and they may live next door to one another. Then, lo and behold, they become the age of 5 years of age to go to the primary school. The little Protestant boy goes to the non-denominational school, which is for all faiths, and the little Roman Catholic fella to another school to meet people he doesn't know. They come back during the day and they still play with one another, and it doesn't concern them, but they find that there's something different here. Then they go to secondary school, and that's where I would think the sectarian bigotry would set in, and they start to hate each other for no apparent reason.
We don't have any contact, really, in school with people from the Protestant school. I don't really know anybody from the Protestant school in our area.
It is the old Jesuit thing. Give me a child at 7 years of age and I have him for life. And that's why they want to maintain that, so they can... And I'll say this openly, they will corrupt that child's mind all through its educational process.
You're looking lovely.
With regard to organisations such as the Orange Order and the Bernian Movement, I would ask anyone who belongs to either of these organisations to ask themselves if by being a member of that particular organisation, does it make you a better Christian and therefore enhance the lives of the people that you come in contact with? If the answer is yes, then fine. But if it's no, then I would say that that particular organisation is a negative force in Scottish society.
Now, when people say to me that you're a sectarian bigot, I'll say you're the bigot, because I'm marching for my belief. And if you wanted to march democratically for your belief, I wouldn't perhaps like it, but I wouldn't object to it, because I don't like your principles. I don't like the principles of Roman Catholicism.
This is the senior office bearers of each private lodge within the district, including the ladies who come and see the district master, give them a good sending off, give them a great start these day, give them the best wishes. This is the biggest event in our calendar on a yearly basis. We look forward to the sun shining. God always looks after his own.
Always good to his own, Charlie. You're right. We order, please, for the service. Please.
I'd like to start off this morning short service of worship by singing the first verse of Psalm 100. All people that on earth do dwell.
All people that on earth do dwell, sing to the Lord with cheerful voice. Himself with wealth is praise forever. Come ye before him and rejoice.
Our Heavenly Father, we are gathered together in thy name. We bless thee for the land of our birth, for the Protestant freedom we enjoy. We remember with gratitude thy victorious servant, King William III, who now destroys up to deliver...
The Saturday normally prior to the 12th of July, our district and its associate lodges take part in the annual July celebrations. In the morning we will march through the village of Hart Hill, and in the afternoon we go off to the annual celebrations, which this year is taking place in Airdrie. Orangism for me is an enhancement of my Christian beliefs. We are defenders of the faith. We want to make sure that our country, Scotland, which is 4.5 million Protestants, remains that religion.
I think it's harder for young people these days to be religious because of all the distractions and influences that we have around us. We tend to use the phrase in this day and age an awful lot, and I think we use it sometimes as an excuse to do what we want to do as opposed to what our Christian faith tells us to do.
It's such sweet place where freedom flows and is gold, the shankill their colours are red, white and blue. No other colours will ever do.
Last night I saw my darling making a ball. Hooray, chirpy, chirpy, cheep, cheep. Woke up this morning and the chapel was gone.
Chirpy,
chirpy, cheep, cheep, chirpy, chirpy, cheep, cheep.
Where's the chapel?
Where's
the chapel gone?
This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all. so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me.
Body of Christ,
the Eucharist, I believe, is the child who is tired and afraid and is picked up by his mother and held closely to her. And after a few minutes, the tension and fear drains out of the child. The Eucharist is like that. When we come before the Eucharist or receive the Eucharist, God picks us up and holds us close to him.
It's only a symbolism when we have Holy Communion in our church. Now, they have the sacrament of the Holy Mass at a whim. Now, if I just make a wee example for you, and I don't want to be offensive to anybody who's a Roman Catholic, but I'm trying to enlighten them. If I take this piece of bread here and cut it in two, and I go to any priest, I go to the Pope himself and I say, go on, Pope, make that the body of Christ. And he does these hocus pocus. I'll ask him then to turn his back, and I'll juggle them up, and I'll ask him, which one is Jesus Christ, or which one is God? Jesus Christ. Show me who it is. Tell me which one it is. He can't tell me, because they both look the same, and they both taste the same. It is playing with people's minds, it is insulting to God, and it's totally against Scripture. And it confuses me, and it makes me very furious. And I just wish sometimes that maybe people would think that way.
Mm-hmm. Mary's confined to the house. There's no way she can get out to Mass now.
Who does eat my flesh and drink my blood?
I'm a Eucharistic minister, so therefore I can bring Mary communion every week. Normally, in this parish, she would receive communion from the priest, but he can only do it on a monthly basis. To receive the body of Christ, it's Jesus living inside us, so therefore it's very important.
So whoever eats me will draw life from me.
The body of Christ.
No! This is a statement of our loyalty to our faith, our loyalty to our country, our loyalty to our monarchy, that we are unionists, we are loyalists, and this is a statement of our belief and our allegiance to that.
You hear those bands playing and when the master says, let's go. It's an amazing feeling of happiness. It's just a fabulous day. You're like a child on Christmas Eve. That's what the men and women are like.
Well, here we are in Carfin Grotto for the National Pilgrimage, and there will be people from all over Scotland here today. I would estimate between 2,000 and 3,000 people. The chief celebrant for the Mass today will be Cardinal Winning, and I would imagine most of the bishops, if not all of the bishops, will be here, plus many priests from the various parishes throughout Scotland. The Mass will be, the theme of the Mass, I would imagine, would be for the family and possibly for world peace.
I think that some of the rulings that are criticised by non-Catholics, for example, divorce, contraception and so on, these things are not easy for Catholics. They're not rules put before us to make life more difficult for us. They are actually the teachings of Christ, and therefore neither the Pope, the bishops, none of the hierarchy can't change the teachings of Christ. The teachings of Christ are maybe very difficult, but we have to either accept everything in the teaching or reject everything. It's as simple as that. I would think that any of these marches certainly would intimidate the Catholic faith. I don't think anything will ever convince me that my faith is wrong. It's too strong, and I hope it always remains so.
Roman Catholicism quite literally states, give me England and I have the world. Now, I would extend that. If the Roman Catholic faith becomes so strong that it becomes the National Church, for that matter, we are on the sliding scale to hell. I would say if we became a totally Roman Catholic nation, we'd become not a fascist state, but a dictatorial state. I have no doubt about that. The priest, the bishop, the cardinals snap their fingers and the Roman Catholic nation jump.
The Pope is the Vicar of Christ. The first Pope, of course, was St. Peter, who was handed the authority of Christ. Each Pope is a successor of St. Peter and therefore rules with the authority of Christ.
You can't have a monarch in Britain that's a Roman Catholic, that's right. And I will never ever encourage it to be changed. I will always wish our monarch to remain Protestant, because what happened over 300 years ago, and by having our monarchy from the Protestant faith, I think we secure freedom and civil liberties for everybody. We're protesting against Roman Catholicism through their dogma. They mislead people. It's an insult to God. It's an insult to man's intelligence. It's hocus pocus.
There seems to be a popular belief among non-Catholics. They think that we worship statues, we pray to statues and so on. That's not the case. When we stand in front of a statue praying, we're not actually praying to the statue. The statue is there, in a sense, to remind us of who we are speaking to. Our prayers don't terminate at the statue, but go beyond that. I don't feel controlled or brainwashed in the way that we live out our faith. If that was the case, then I would reject the Catholic faith, but it certainly isn't the case. I'm happy to live the Catholic faith.
In the book of Revelation, it is written that Jesus Christ says, "Come out of that great whore, and those of you who remain in it will be damned." I firmly believe that when Jesus Christ speaks that, he's speaking about the Roman Catholic Church. People are being lost and they have to wake up and come out. I think they're being sent to the road to eternal hell, and I really pray for them.
Inside this tiny PC is a big built-in advantage. We make it with technology so advanced, it will handle the software of the future. Our home entertainment system has the latest Intel Pentium 2 processor. It gives you awesome graphics at breathtaking speed. Yet all this quality comes at a remarkably low price. Because we don't just make our PCs, we sell them direct in our own nationwide showrooms. Come and see amazing tiny PCs with Intel Pentium 2 processors. Call 0800 321 000 for your nearest showroom.
Chat and date. Call friends and swap telephone numbers 0894 79 79
79. Fox Hits 98 Volume 2. The biggest hits on the planet. Fox Hits 2, out now at Woolworths.
Republicans and Loyalists in Northern Ireland looked to Scotland for friendship and support. flute bands of both faiths are proud to link hands across the water.
I'm Thomas Boylan. I live in the East End of Glasgow and I'm a member of the Ballyreid Republican Flute Band. The band was formed in 1978 in Parkhead area for to further the aims of a Republican movement in Scotland. It's named after Ballyreid, an IRA volunteer from North Belfast. He was killed in action in 1971.
My name's Josh Henderson. Stay in a village, Shieldhill, near Falkirk, and I play the flute in Shieldhill Young Defenders Flute Band, which I have been for 14 years. I'd say the village is like any other village, rural village, like. I would say mostly it is Protestant. The villages all up this area are probably the same. They've all got flute bands, they've all got lodges. Throughout the area, like if you see you come from Shieldhill, it's obviously the same, yeah, where Catholics stay up in trees and things like this, but that's just a joke, just banter, I suppose.
In an Ireland, you have nationalist and loyalist areas are kind of separated, so they don't have much day-to-day contact with each other. In Scotland, we're all mixed. In the East End of Glasgow's in certain areas, you do have to mix with Protestants and loyalists.
The kids just have to look at the place they're in. This is a pit, you know what I mean? There's nothing here for them, you know what I mean? Nothing at all. People tend either to turn to football and politics rather than hanging about street corners doing nothing. I mean, it's an outlet for them, joining a flute band. It's something to be part of, something to be proud of, rather than just hanging about here all day and chased by the police for various things.
It's all about tradition. I mean, if you look at other traditions or other religions, they've all got some, and nobody complains about that. I mean, we're here, we're making a statement, we're actually celebrating what happened 300 years ago. We're celebrating getting away from Rome. Why should we not celebrate that?
Right. We have the band's badge. It's basically a replica of what's on a tie. A phoenix. Parkhead, that's the district we come from, and Chucky Allah. That's Gaelic for the day will come. He'll put his hat on for him. He's Hackle at the side. And tails and down the back. So I'm very proud of him. There's not a lot of kids his age tend to be interested in what Thomas is interested in. He has other social activities now, but his main one is with the band.
We are the Shieldhill Young Defenders and we're going over to Northern Ireland to support Ulster's cause. We're going over there to traditional march, 12th of July. It's part of our heritage, part of their heritage.
This is the flag island, the tricolour. It means quite a bit to us, flying it in Scotland, because... Oh, back it up. Although we're not staying in Ireland, we still have very close links with the country. And to fly this in Scotland makes us proud. Also, I know there's a few people as well, so... That's not too bad. My first loyalty would be to Ireland. Although I am Scottish, I'm not ashamed of the fact I'm Scottish, but I do support the Irish struggle first and foremost. My parents were Irish and my relatives are Irish, so therefore I feel I have to represent them.
The Republican bands, I mean, they're working for what? For terrorists. I mean, if you ask Republican bands what their main aim is, political. Our aim isn't political, ours is about religion, ours is about freedom and religion.
Our band's attitude to the IRAs are a guerrilla army and they're fighting a war in Ireland. So therefore we support the ideals and ideologies that they have.
To my eyes, they're scum anyway. I mean, they're not Scottish. It's all about Southern Ireland. For him to say that he's Scottish, but he would rather back the IRA. But what happens if it came to a war? Would he fight for this country? Or whose country would he fight for?
It's basically the hate for what we stand for, what we represent, which is everything they're against. I mean, on a day-to-day basis, they don't walk by and want to murder you, but when they're in large congregations, when there are big crowds of them, it's then that you really know how much they detest you.
A couple of minutes, the bands will assemble and get ready to march off. We'll be heading towards Parkhead, Celtic Park, up through the surrounding areas. Basically, what we are saying to the British is, we want you to leave Ireland. And every time we march on the street, that is basically what we're telling them.
I see the links between the Ulster Protestants, Scottish Protestants, as being, we're the only nation in the whole of the United Kingdom to really stand by them. I think they're looking towards us to say, well, we've got an ally here. And I think the lines go back that many years now. I don't think anybody could cut each other for anybody else. I think we've got to stay with each other. I mean, it's hands across the water. It's got to be hands across the water.
Say that 90% of the band being Catholic is because of the Irish immigration situation back in the 40s and 50s when Irish people came to Glasgow and Liverpool and Manchester and settled here. Most of their kids that's grown up today, their sons are all in the band, so therefore they would tend to be more Catholics than Protestants. Well, we get a very good response when we're out in the streets. The people come out and show their support for the bands, whether it be family or friends or whatever. But we do have a strong support in the East End of Glasgow. And it's hard to run an organisation in Scotland that's supportive to the Republican movement in Ireland. People tend to treat you with contempt. If people are offended by your presence, obviously they must have a reason for it, which might be that their son was shot dead by the IRA.
To rule Ulster, which will never happen. Never.
Think of the words of the sash. Think of the words. Should it sold?
And his colours stay off the set. It was long.
My God!
The days of glory.
after me.
Says my father.
The Loyalists would be more outward because they really have nothing to fear. They have all the government forces and things beside them and there to help them. Being a Republican in Glasgow is very hard. You have to watch your personal security all the time. You have to watch the security of your family and your house. I believe that the IRA have served its purpose up to today. There is now a ceasefire a year old in Ireland. Britain was brought to the negotiating table by the Republican movement and their actions, but we see now that it should be all party talks and full remission for the prisoners.
Is that not a bonfire? Is that not a bonfire? It's a beacon throughout six counties. Right at this moment now, the government, I think, is ready to sell them down the river. With a ceasefire, the IRA, giving concessions to the IRA, the people won't have it. I mean, if it was to come to your own doorstep, you wouldn't take it yourself. They're going to alienate the Protestants now, drive them away. Where are they going to go, like?
Hands across the water. Right. I know we, Johnny, all right. That's where he joined 2 weeks ago. Man, he's as drunk now as what he was there.
I would say the message sent out is making is unionism is still here. It's here to stay.
I've got a lot of friends over in Ulster. I couldn't let them down if it push came to shove. I mean, what would happen? I mean, is the rest of Britain going to support them? Are they just going to let them sail on down the river? We'd have to give them some kind of support.
One of the chaps on the walk said to me, it's a hell of a funny why we're going around Barrowfield and Shettleson and Mother. And he was right, it was a slum areas. We're not walking around Giffnock, we're not walking around Shawlands. Why not? There's no Catholics here.
They have a terrorist organisation. They've got the UDA there, murderers. We're no murderers, we're an army fighting for the right for the Irish freedom.
Rebels from over the border they come, and they tell them this land is not theirs to own. They say they must go, but to where I don't know, for Ulster was always their home.
Scotland and Ulster, the links are strong. It's a great honour to be over in Ulster. I mean, not many bands do it, and I think it's showing your support that we're not forgetting about them.
When their grandfathers fought long ago with the volunteers.
People want to label us as sectarian. I don't class myself as being sectarian. I class myself as being a Protestant traditionalist for the right to work for a religion. I can't possibly see a United Ireland happening in my lifetime. Ulster Protestants wouldn't stand for it. Certain people in Scotland would rally around and make sure it didn't happen. I think that the peace process is doing very well and I hope it works, but no concessions to the aggressor.
We tend to stick to our own bars, the Republicans. We stick to places that we know accept us. And I dare say it's the same with the Loyalists, but they kind of have a more free rein than us. We can basically go anywhere we want.
Take it down from us, Irish traitors. It's a flag we will be generous, claim. It can never be wrong to free slavers.
now we're getting to the fact that the police, the councils, all the rest of it are trying to say, well, the ceasefire's working over here, so we should stop marching. So they're trying to cut back, they're trying to stop you walking traditional routes. Even in Scotland now they're trying to do it.
I was attacked myself when I was leaving a bar in the east end of Glasgow with three guys, and they made it quite plain. The reason why they were attacking me was because I was in a flute band. One of them pulled a knife at, and there was a couple of strangers passing by, and they ran over and helped me. The loyalists ran away and jumped into a car and drove off.
Scotland's not a nation that we don't know nothing about the religious divide in Scotland. The only difference between Scotland and Ulster, I would think, is there are no guns in the street. I mean, you get it in building sites, you get it in pubs. Certain pubs you can't go into, certain areas you can't go into, certain towns you can't go into, certain villages you can't go into. So where's the difference? The difference is that the guns aren't here yet, and hopefully it'll never happen.